Lord, we want to thank you. We thank you for all the goodness and your mercies that you give in our lives, Lord. We thank you for the time of fellowship, the time of laughter. And Lord, this all means that we value one another in our lives. Lord, even as we sit here and listen from your words, be with us, Lord, and let your spirit guide us. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. I am happy about this morning's worship, mainly because I see people could get up from their places, look around, and know who are here and where they are sitting. Mainly because I still wanted to look around the church today and see who is sitting where, because this might come handy as we reach towards the end of the sermon. I know we feel nice, comfortable where we are sitting. It feels nice, but I like making people a bit uncomfortable and asking them to get up from their places. So this is what we would be doing when we reach at the end of the sermon. We started with a sermon series last time when I spoke. And this is a very important question. Any clue of what did we speak about last time? We spoke about Revelation. We ended up that sermon with a very important question. What was the question? And I'm happy Hannah's hand is there.
The question was, what will Christ write about us as Greenford Baptist Church if he returns today?
Yes. We spoke about the seven letters that are in the book of Revelation, and we said Christ wrote these letters to these churches. Christ focused on various things in this book. And in these letters, we looked at three important points, said Christ cares for his church, and that's where he was walking in those lampstands, and we spoke about it. We also said that it is our choice to make what we have to do. That's where every letter ends with the line, those who has ears should listen, and then our choices will have its own consequences. That's what we said all the letters are mainly focused on. And then we said, if Christ writes a letter today, what would he say to us? And we asked ourselves the question, what about us? And this is what we are going to do in our few sermons that would follow. And every time we see a letter, we would stand and ask ourselves, what about us? If Christ had something like this to say to this church, then what about us? Does this apply to us? Do we need to learn something from them? And we would be thinking about all these various aspects that Christ spoke to these churches. Today we are going to deal with the first letter in seven letters that Christ wrote in book of Revelation, chapter 2 and verse 1 to verse 7. Now the first letter in these seven letters is written to the city of Ephesus. Now city of Ephesus is one of those cities in New Testament which has a lot of connections with the New Testament. Now, this city, the church in this city, was established by Paul when he was on his missionary journey. Paul spent almost about 3 years in this particular city in developing the church and serving the Lord. It is also said that Paul sold his tents. Paul was a tent maker. So he made tents and also sold his tents in this city, because this city was one of the prominent cities in Asia Minor, as the biblical time regions is called as, which in a present day is a part of Turkey. This city was a very prominent city back then. In this city was one of the Asian seven wonders, And that is a temple for the goddess Dinah. Now, interestingly, this city is one of few cities in biblical times that has been excavated well enough, and a lot of details of this city we are aware of. So this various aspects of this city makes it more interesting when we look at the book of the letter to the Ephesus and this particular letter when Christ speaks to them. This city was one of the main business hub. It had a big port. It was well connected by roads to major cities in that region. So it was a commercial center. It was a religious center. Not only that, few centuries later, when after the book of Revelation was written, there was a big library that was started in the city of Ephesus. But none of that exists today, because then the history in the due course of time was happened and the city was devastated and all that stuff. But this was a prominent city. Timothy, when Paul wrote a letter to Timothy, Timothy was serving to the church in this church of Ephesus. Apollos, mentioned in the book of Acts, was found by Aquila and Priscilla in the city of Ephesus. And that's where they took him and helped him grow in God's word. John, who wrote this book, also is said that he lived in the city for a number of years. So there's a lot of stuff that happened in this city of Ephesus during the New Testament time. And to such city, which was always surrounded by godly people, always surrounded by key leaders of those times in the church, always surrounded by a lot of different people from various cities and regions coming in, a lot of different religious belief, Christ chooses to write his first letter. And let me tell you, the introductions of all the letters where Christ talks about himself in the words saying the angel are very interesting. Now, it says in verse 1, to the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walk among the seven golden lampstands. Now, the phrase right hand, if I say right-hand man, it gives us a good idea, right? Sadly, I don't know if in Indian society, right-hand man, whenever we say it now, it would be looked at as a very negative aspect. In a say, he is a right-hand man of a goon or someone who is involved in a crime. But then the right-hand thing, the right-hand phrase in the biblical times is a repeatedly used phrase in biblical literature. That means that the person who is at the right hand is a person of great importance, is a person who is trusted well, is a person who can be entrusted for important tasks. And God says here that he holds the seven star in his right hand. Now, who are the seven stars? What are the seven stars? Let's move a chapter back in chapter 1 and verse 20. It says the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. So these stars that Christ has in his hand are the angels to the churches. Now these angels, when referred to, it is spoken about the leaders of the churches, the one who are given the responsibility of leading these churches. So Christ says, these leaders who are leading these churches, they are in my hand, they are important for me, and they are entrusted with a very, very important responsibility. Now, when I say this, that they are the leaders of the churches, it makes us feel nice, right? Because I'm not the leader. I just come to the church, I just attend a church, and I go. And then we look at Pastor Warren, leader. And then we look at the leaders of the church, and they say, leader. But the Bible says that we are the priests in his order. Who are the priests? Every one of us. So when we are part of the Christ's community, when we are the part of church, it is we, those who are entrusted with a great responsibility. Now, if we move forward in verse 2 and verse 3, it says, I know your deeds, your hard work, and your presence. Now, these three lines has a parallel in remaining parts of the verse. So then he says, I know your deeds. So when he says, I know your deeds, what kind of deeds he is talking about? That you cannot tolerate wicked. Then he says, I know your hard works. So what are the hard works that he's talking about? That you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not. And then he talks about the perseverance of the church. And the church is praised for this thing. Now, it feels nice when someone talks good about us. I'm sorry, I end up giving a lot of examples of my family and mostly Sheba, so I have a hard time all the time when I preach and then go back home. But good thing is the food is ready, so that helps a bit. But then it happens with us that whenever Sheba does something, I am the one who comes up with the most negative things regarding whatever she does. So she is kind of fed up with that and she started saying, stop it. Come up with something good. So here's a church that has been talked about the good things that they are doing. And Christ is saying to them, I know your deeds, that you cannot tolerate wicked. Now this church, as we have said, was a very important commercial center. It was also a religious center. So it had people coming from different regions. It had people coming with different ideologies. It had people coming from different thought processes. And they were influencing the society. They were influencing the church because church is a part of a society. So there were things that were just flowing into the society, and the church, under the guidance of all the leaders, those who were part of that church, and we are talking about the greats like Paul, Timothy, John, and other leaders, those who were serving there, were trained so well, were taught about God's word so well, that it had become their habit, a part of their life, that they could see things that are not right and they would make sure that they don't enter the church. Now, interestingly, Paul in Book of Acts had told them that false teachers and wrong things will enter the church. Now, when Paul was taken as a prisoner, he had a brief meet with the people of Ephesus and he then told them that you need to be aware of false teachers. So, they knew the situation would come. They knew that we would be under attack. They knew that there would be things that we need to make sure doesn't enter the church. So they were rightly doing as they were taught. Now, Timothy, when Paul wrote to Timothy, he spoke about one important concern. Now, that has caused a lot of theological controversies around the world. He spoke about women. That woman should cover her head. Is it Timothy, right? And not speak much. Oh, it's Corinthians. I'm sorry, I'm getting confused. Corinthians, sorry. But then, I'm sorry. That happens. But then when Paul wrote to Timothy, he spoke about false teachers, he spoke about the relationships, and he spoke about having a healthy relationship with one another and with the Lord. And this church was aware of the things that they should not allow in the church. So, Christ looks at them and says that I know that you understand what is right and what is wrong. I know that you understand the wicked deeds that should not be a part of the church. And I appreciate that. That's a good thing. He goes to a step further and he says, I know that you work hard to make sure to identify a person who is really from God and who is not from God. Now the Bible says that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not and have found them false. Now it takes effort. It takes courage. And in the presence here, it really takes a lot of courage to stand someone and say, sorry, what you're telling is not right. But for us to be in that position, it is important that we know what we believe. We know what is right. We know what is a proper teaching of the church. And this was happening in the early church when the church was quite young, when there was a chaotic time, when there was a confusion about Christianity being part of Judaism or Christianity is a different religion and all that stuff. There were a lot of individuals who used to come and used to talk about different aspects that were not actually part of the church teaching. One of such thing is also mentioned in verse 6. It says, but you have this in your favor. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. So this church not only made sure that wrong things doesn't become a part of the church, but they also made sure that the wrong teachings that would take the church from God were not part of the church. And Nicolaitans, now nothing much is actually known about the whole practice of Nicolaitans, but it is said that it was started by a person named Nicholas, and he, being part of the Jewish society, wanted to make sure that there should be a middle way, because when Christianity was introduced in the church in Ephesus, people were worshipping various gods, and Diana goddess, being a city god of the Ephesus, she was a main god who was worshipped in the church. In the city. So when Christianity was introduced in the city, or Christianity was brought to them, or the gospel was brought to them, they stopped worshipping, or they moved away from their old practices and committed their lives to Christ. Now, this was not a possibility for everyone to do it, to leave away everything that they were doing and move away to a different faith or a right way of salvation was not an easy and possible way for everybody. So then Nicholas came up and he said, okay, I understand Christ is the way of salvation, but these things are valid because he forgives all the sins. Because he is okay with this, so you can follow Christ, you can be part of the church and still do these things. So that's valid, that's okay. And that was not a right teaching that church was taught about. Church talks about renewing our lives, giving away our old lives. And Nicholas says, some part of the old life and some part of the new life That's fine, and you can have your own life. But the church was very sure, even in that they didn't allow these practices of this Nicolaitans to be involved in the church, and they made sure, no, either it has to be black or it has to be white. You cannot have a gray. So it has to be your old life or it has to be a new life. You cannot just mix both of them and still continue to do that. The church today that we exist in the society is also facing a great danger in various ways. Now, we live in an information age. A lot more information is produced each day than the day that has gone by. You open internet, you type one word, and you have n numbers of articles available on that particular subject matter. Now, there are a lot of individuals who also speak about various factors in the Bible. Now, this is a very, very important topic and a very, very delicate topic. So I need to be very, very sure the way I put on my things. So there are a lot of individuals who read few things from the Bible and they come up with their own understanding. And the church, in many ways, is vulnerable to this situation if we are not careful. I really don't want to go into depth to this because I don't want to end up making anybody uncomfortable here. But then one of the things that I really speak about all the time is the word blessing. And I think I've already spoken about this in our church. Now, there are a lot of people who end up having the understanding of blessing in a very materialistic way. Whenever the church talks about blessings, we speak about, we think that it is all about money, cars, big house, a lavish life, a comfortable life. And that is not something that Bible talks about. That is not that's not the blessing that Christ assured us. Now, for me, if we have to understand what Bible talks about on any particular subject matter, we need to make sure that we look at all the various contexts where it has been spoken about. We need to look at all the various verses where they have been mentioned, and we need to understand the totality what the Bible talks about it. Because I understand Christ did not give us the word of God so that we can make our own ways. Christ didn't, we don't have a Bible so that we can understand Bible from the way we have understood it and live our own lives. There is one message in the Bible, and there is one way of understanding it, and that is by the guidance of Holy Spirit. And when Holy Spirit guides, there is no place for false apostles to become a part of the church. So for us, the church that is present in the present society, we need to be very, very sure of the message that we receive from various individuals and need to make sure that it is the one that Bible talks about. And that is what this city of Ephesus was doing. Now, it is really hard, as I said a little while ago, to stand at someone's face and say, sorry, you're wrong. As I said last time also, we are living in a very opinionated society now. You type one thing on a Facebook or a Twitter, and there are 110, lot of different views that come up with that. And the same thing is regarding the Bible. You say something about one aspect, and then everyone comes up with their own view. But then let's wait. Let's sit together. Let's ask God, what is that exactly? Bible talks about this. Let's ask the Spirit of God. And this is what the church of Ephesus was doing. They were together and they were doing what God was wanting them. Third thing that they are praised about is their perseverance. Now, church of Ephesus did face problem. Paul when serving in the church of Ephesus, in the city of Ephesus, did face a problem. If we turn to Book of Acts chapter 19, starting from verse 23, it says there was a riot in Ephesus. And you know what was the cause for the riot? Most of the people, those who were going to this temple, buying the idols and making a profit for these idol makers, were in a fix because their business was going down. And why was their business going down? Because a lot of people started learning about Christ. So these people were not comfortable with these changes that are happening because their pockets were getting empty, and therefore it gave rise to the riots. So this church of Ephesus was continuously facing situation which were not really easy, which didn't make them easier for them to meet. But then they stood strong in those situations. They handled situations whenever it came. They went on with all the failures, with all the difficulties that they had. They went on to worship the Lord. Now, before coming to verse 4, and before really asking you to move around a little bit, the verse 7 says, "He who has an ear, let him hear what Spirit says to the church. To him who overcomes," now what we have to overcome is what we are going to see after a while, "I will give the right to eat from the tree of life." Now where was this tree of life? Where in the Bible do we see or hear about tree of life? In the Garden of Eden. But here it says tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. Now if we decide, what we have to decide is what we are going to see, then we would be a part of his paradise. Church of Ephesus looks a good church, right? It knows what is not right. It knows what is the false teaching. It knows how to stick on to their faith. And it would be a nice place. It would be a nice fellowship to be a part of. And if the letter would have just said this much, it would have been really made that church feel nice. They would have made a big frame and would have kept it somewhere in the church and said, they would have said, "See, look at the letter that we have received from Christ." Would have really made them happy. But then, there was a problem in the church. And what was the problem? In verse 4, it says, "You're good. There are things that you are really doing fine. But yet, I hold this against you." And what is against them? That they or you have forsaken your first love. Remember the height from which you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. Now it says, "If you don't repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place." You have forgotten your first love. Now, the phrase "first love" has invited various views again. Someone says it is about it focuses mainly about the love on God. Someone says it focuses mainly about the love among one another. But then, in either of the cases, be it love on God or be it love to my fellow beings, the love was not part of the church. Now, this was a difficult situation even for me to understand. The church is good. It follows word of God. It knows what is right. It is not allowing wrong teachings to become a part of the church. And at other side, it says you have fallen from your first love. So they know all the teachings. They know what is right. They know what they're supposed to do, what they're not supposed to do. And yet, there was no love. Well, we had a long argument on this at home. Friday for about 1 hour, Sheba and I sat and spoke about this. But this, and then sometimes we end up saying, this cannot be the situation. How can this be a possibility? If we know word of God, if we follow it, if we make sure it is done in a proper way, then how can there be a situation where we don't have a love? And this is something difficult, and a difficult thing to understand and accept. But here in Church of Ephesus, Christ is pointing out that very situation. He said, you can do all things. You know word of God, you know what is right, you know what is wrong, you know, you can do everything to make sure the church grows in a way that you're taught about, but yet there can be a situation where you might miss out on the love aspect of the church. Now, I remember a few months ago, before we went to the smaller place, smaller hall, and we were still worshiping here, a sermon was preached in the church, and we spoke about the bricks and the cements. And someone was asked to remove the brick and said, can that be a possibility? And someone said, no. So love is a topic that we speak about a lot. But I just don't want to speak about love today. I really wanted to do something in the church which might be good, or which might make someone get up from the place, or everybody from the place. But the church of Ephesus lacked that. There was no love in the church. They had fallen from that love. You know, for me, the church of Acts is a prototype of the church, the way the church should function today. And I really liked what it is said about the church of Acts in chapter 4 and verse 34. In book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 34. It says, there were no needy people among them. Now, this whole church of Acts was in a very regular practice of making sure that anybody's needs be met. Now, in two places, wherever it talks about this, it basically talks about money. But if we look around in our world today, the needs are not just about finances. The needs go much more beyond money. The need goes much more beyond having someone to sit next to the person and hear what the person is going through. There is a need for many around in our society, for many around in our church, to have that quality time, to have a friend whom we can entrust, to have a friend to help us walk a little further in our life. Now, the church is a place which, for me, should be a place which help us recharge so that we can go back to the world, go back to the community, and share the same energy, share the same joy that we have received, so that we can go and share that with the community and share the joy with them. But when does that happen? When we are strong as a community of Christ. And when do we become strong? By coming to church every Sunday? Yeah, part of it, yes. It happens mainly when we talk to one another, when we share about our lives, when we open ourselves, and we share God's experiences that we have in our lives. And the church of Ephesus must have been very busy in a lot of things that they had to take care of. But maybe that's the area where they couldn't spend time, couldn't love their fellow mates, church brothers and sisters. That's the area they failed. And for this reason, Christ tells them that if you don't repent, I will remove your lampstand. So it's not a simple thing. It shows us the seriousness of what the consequences of this can be. So this is what I wanted to do, and I really don't know how it's going to work. So if you see I'm failing, Pastor Warren, you need to help me in that. Let's see. Let's all get up from our places. Yeah? If you're able to, yes. See, that's where he is good sitting here. He can help me all the time. Let's look around one another. Don't worry, I'm not just going to ask you to pray and end this thing, okay? If you can get up, if you can stand, and if you can look at around one another in the church, we can always see at least one person or two people or few people around in the church with whom we can look and say, oh, no, not your friends, not your friends. Oh, this is a person I haven't spoken with for the long time. Oh, this is a person who comes to the church, but I even don't know the name. Now, don't ask me for the names, okay? I'm very bad in that. But then, I really want all of us to move from our places and get hold of one person that we haven't actually spent time with from a long time, or we haven't spent a time with at all. And let's be with that person, if possible, till the end of the worship and during our tea time. And let's try to know one another more. Because I'm happy Pastor Warren spoke about turning. This is what we'll have to do. At least we know the faces. But when we go for turning, if I can speak about this, when we go on for a turning, they don't come to the church. We'll have to do it. So if you can move around from your places. Now since you can stand, we can move out, right? So that's another possibility. Let's get hold of someone with whom we haven't actually spoken much, or we haven't spoken at all, and let's spend time with them.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.